Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Welcome to today's Council on Foreign Relations meeting. I'm obliged to tell you, and I mean it, please cut off all devices, anything that murmurs and trembles and makes noise, and cut it all the way off, because if you don't, it interferes with the sound system up here. Today is going to be a lot easier for me than the last time I was on stage with Pete Peterson, because that time I had to sing love songs to him, literally. Now, Pete has written an informative and entertaining book about his life that we're going to talk about today, and there are many accomplishments in that book, but for this reader, an old friend of Pete's, none are greater than his having married Joan Ganz Cooney. At the time of Pete's 65th birthday in 1991, Joan staged an extravaganza at the Tavern on the Green that featured a number of Pete's friends like Mike Nichols, Roger Altman, Julian Nicolini of the Four Seasons Grill, and his partner Steve Schwartzman acting out a skit dressed in a Japanese kimono. Ted Sorensen gave one of his memorable roasts, in the middle of which he pronounced a serpentine, convoluted sentence that just seemed to go on forever. And it caught all of us by surprise, because Ted is famed for the beauty and balance of his oratory. While we sat there dumbfounded, Ted turned to Joan and said, "I told you I could get the words Pete Peterson and humble into the same sentence." Joan wanted the final touch that night to be songs that captured the romantic feelings that she had for Pete, but Joan confessed she didn't know how to sing. I had a little cabaret performing sideline going on in those days, so by prearrangement, Joan brought me to the stage and told the crowd that while the voice was mine, the sentiments were hers, which is why I had to look Pete Peterson deep in the eyes and tell him, "There's a small hotel with a wishing well. I wish that we were there together." That wasn't bad enough. The next one from the film High Society was, "I've no proof when people say you're more or less aloof, but you're sensational. I don't care if you are known as Fair Mr. Frigidaire." Pete tells the story of that party in his book, but he left out my contribution, so I thought I'd just fill in the gap. But I have a larger purpose here. Pete's life has been, as the title suggests, a fulfillment of the American dream, and it's a whale of a story. But where this book stands out from the usual self-regarding mogul's memoir is Pete's sense of humor about himself. Pete tells of the time that the New Yorker writer Ken Auletta reported after Pete's troubled departure from Lehman Brothers that some of his partners there had deemed him imperious. One night when he is in bed with Joan, Pete asks her, "Darling, do you find me imperious?" And Joan answers, "Absolutely not, Mr. Peterson." Now 83 years old, Pete was a child of the Great Depression, raised by immigrant Greek parents in a small town in Nebraska, equidistant from San Francisco and Boston. I know you have Pete's biography, but let me race through the highlights because they really are so dazzling. A marketing whiz in Chicago, he becomes vice president of McCann Erickson at the age of 27. By 34, he is president of a major manufacturing company, Bell & Howell. In 1971, he becomes the international economics advisor to President Nixon, and soon after, the Secretary of Commerce. The next step is chairman and CEO of Lehman Brothers in 1973. Along the way, he creates the Institute for International Economics in Washington that now bears his name, and becomes chairman of the board of the New York Fed. In 1985, he succeeds David Rockefeller as chairman of the Council on Foreign Relations, a place which Nixon warned him was full of, quote, "old farts and airheads." That same year, he co-founds the Blackstone Group, the private investment banking firm that amassed a worth of $31 billion and produced for Pete a check for $1.85 billion when it went public in June 2007. Pete, when I became London bureau chief of the New York Times and suddenly had a place in London where people could bunk, I discovered I had a whole bunch of friends I never knew I had before. And I'm thinking you must have had a lot of people at your door, distant acquaintances that suddenly showed up at that point. Now, I hate to admit it, but Pete has also composed some compelling long-form journalism and written best-selling books, though he concedes that the ones that focused on the federal deficit were, quote, not exactly beach-reading favorites. So what do you do with $1 billion burning a hole in your pocket? Pete has used it to create the Peter G. Peterson Foundation, which is trying to get us to act by scaring the hell out of us, targeting the unsustainability of our costly lifestyle, current lifestyle, and warning of the threat of national insolvency if we don't change our ways. We'll hear more from that from Pete a little later. Pete was forced from the Nixon administration when he fell out of favor with H.R. Haldeman and the Palace Guard. But as always, Pete got the last laugh. At his Washington farewell party, he famously said that he had flunked the Nixon loyalty test because, quote, my calves are so fat that I couldn't click my heels. On to the book. I said earlier that it stands out from the rest because of Pete's sense of fun. But maybe even more importantly, it is remarkable for its painful self-revelation. So, Pete, let's talk about the book, and let's start at the beginning, because it's a remarkable place for a self-made billionaire to have come from, and it clearly had a great influence on you.
Well, I might finish that Nixon story, if I may, because it relates to the council. And one of the last times I saw him, he took me through an hour and a half of the most brilliant coverage of the world, foreign policy-wise, I'd ever heard. And he got to one part of it, and he said, now, Pete, you know, with his jaws moving, this is not something your liberal Eastern friends, you know, those old farts and airheads at the Council on Foreign Relations would agree with. And I said, oh, Mr. President, yeah, I'm fine. So he goes on. To show you the complexity of this man and his generic ambivalence about almost everything, as I'm going out, puts his arm around me and he says, you know my son, Eddie Cox, don't you? And I said, yes, yes, Mr. President. I was in the White House when he married your daughter, Tricia. He says, you could do me a great favor. Could you get him into the council? And I felt like saying, oh, were those young farts in her head? Well, I was telling Susan Mercandetti that the comment that I hear most frequently about this book is how I reveal some personal mistakes and faux pas in a way that most people wouldn't, including, for example, a couple of bouts of psychotherapy. And it's aroused some criticism from some circles as to why would you reveal so much about yourself? And I've thought about that a bit. And I've always liked to look inward. And I have found in life that if you articulate your mistakes and you try to understand why you made those mistakes, the odds are at least a little lower that you're going to repeat those same mistakes. And it's one of the reasons I believe in psychotherapy, where we sometimes hide from ourselves the reasons, the real reasons we do things. And I have found it a very constructive force in my life, even though titans or fat cats or whatever I am aren't supposed to admit that they need psychotherapy. I have found it very useful, and I put it in there for a reason. And that was that I thought people might benefit from knowing that. And I was revealing personally for another reason. I think it is safe to say that the enthusiasm for Wall Street billionaires these days is pretty restrained. More than restrained, I would say. And if you're writing a book and you happen to at least temporarily be one of those Wall Street billionaires, you have to think about how the audience looks at you. And I thought, you know, we've all dug holes for ourselves, some deeper than others. And if the audience understands that even Wall Street titans dig very deep holes in for themselves and somehow manage to get out of the holes that they've created, maybe it would encourage them not only to read the book, but to have a little sense of optimism about the current hole that they're in. So I guess the reason I revealed as much as I did about many aspects of my life is partly for personal reasons and partly because I thought it might make the book more accessible to people.
Mm-hmm. You know, Pete, I was struck in the book by the fact that you actually went into psychotherapy twice, the second time being after the failure of your marriage to Sally. And by the way, I mentioned my high regard for Joan Ganz Cooney. I have an equally high regard for Sally Peterson. You marry terrific women. Mm-hmm. And I was struck, though, by the first time you went to psychotherapy. I think it was in the late 50s. At most, it was the early 60s in Chicago. Nobody went into psychotherapy then.
That's true.
But actually, in that psychotherapy, and I'm going to get you back to Kearney, Nebraska with this question, the psychotherapist took you back to your youth, and you've discovered some patterns there which were illustrative to you when you confronted your own personal problems. Can you just talk a bit about your father, your mother, their association, and how it reflected later on in your own life?
Yeah, an early experience I had as this looks like a group therapy session here, not a typical council meeting. I was having tough times with a tougher time than I should have with a divorce, both that time and later. And in my inquiries as to my early life, I had an experience that apparently had quite a traumatizing experience effect on me. My mother, I was 4 years old at the time. My mother finally had a daughter, and being married to a Greek husband that John Bradamus probably knows, in the middle of a depression can be kind of a double jeopardy kind of marriage. And he was totally preoccupied with his restaurant and his work and so forth. And she had this daughter, and she was born again through the daughter. And at the age of one, this beloved daughter of hers suddenly dies from croup. And she went into, I don't know what the psychological phrase would be, deep, deep melancholia. And like most children, you tend to think you're the sun of the solar system and somehow you're responsible for anything that happens. And she went into very deep melancholia, the deepest kind of depression. And the poor woman, with her preoccupation with this tragedy, was no longer the same mother she was before. And she used to sit there in this kitchen, and I can see her now. I'm standing on this heat register. And there she is, singing a Greek tragedian song, and clearly out of this world psychologically. Well, I felt it as total abandonment. And one of my strategies was I had to get back her attention. Now that is, of course, a remarkably self-absorbed way of looking at it. The woman had deep grounds for mourning as she did. So the strategy I decided is I was going to be this star performer. And I had to get the best grades and the most gold stars and behave well and all that sort of thing. And I learned that lesson too well. And in a couple of previous marriages, I paid much too much attention to being an overachiever and not enough to having a balanced life with a great person. But my last therapy finally woke me up. And if Joan were here, she might admit I'm at least a mediocre husband at the present time. But therapy was immensely helpful to me in understanding why I behaved the way I did and why achieving and always being the youngest and the best grades and all that sort of thing were so important to me. They were a strategy for an earlier experience. I remember Ed Doctorow once said to me, I asked him what a neurosis was, and he said, it's the endless repetition of an obsolete experience or feeling. And I was obviously, as a 50-some-year-old, replaying that little kid who had to achieve and move ahead as a strategy that I had adopted in life. So I commend it to you. I think it's a useful thing to do.
Pete, that's about your mother. Tell me about your father and the influence he had, and economia, that word that...
Economia, right. He came over at age 17 without a word of English and just a few pennies in his pocket and a third-grade education. He goes out to Nebraska, where his older brother was, and he takes a job nobody else wants, as a dishwasher on the caboose of a Union Pacific Railroad that was building the Transcontinental Railroad at that time. The reason nobody wanted it is in the sun, the temperature in Nebraska in the summer is like 110 and no air conditioning. But this permitted him to sleep on the caboose and to eat on the caboose. So he saved about 90% of what he made. And he, in turn, opened up the inevitable Greek restaurant. And it was not noted for its cuisine, but for the fact that it was open 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. It did not close for 25 years, 1 minute. And when he finally decided to shorten the hours, he had to hire a locksmith because he didn't have a key to the front door. And economia, and maybe that's where I get my obsession with budget deficits, I don't know, but he had a sign, I remember, in the little washroom in the restaurant on the paper towel dispenser, why use two when one can do the job? I got quite a education.
Pete, I'm going to jump ahead a little bit in the book. A part of it that I really enjoyed were your experiences.
You didn't enjoy the rest of it?
I knew I was...
Incidentally, if you get nothing else out of this...
I was trying to get through 30 minutes without leaving myself open for one of those lines.
I love Jewish mother jokes, and my favorite is the Jewish mother gives her son two ties Christmas Eve, and he wakes up Christmas morning and he wears one of them, and the mother says, you didn't like the other one?
Anyway, I wanted to talk a little bit about the Nixon administration. I want to ask you if you'd just do some thumbnail sketches of some of the people you described so vividly, like John Connolly, and please don't leave out Chuck Colson and your nickname for him. Actually, could I even ask you this? If you could start the way you started in the book, where you go for breakfast the very first morning you're in the White House, and what your reaction is to that?
Yes, I'm eating in the White House general mess. And I'm there with a bunch of young people, most of them in their 20s, Dwight Chapin, and, you know, some of the others.
Ron Ziegler.
That ended up in a lot of trouble later on. And I had just given up a job as a CEO of a pretty major company to accept a $42,000 salary with five kids in private schools. And I was... aware of the big difference financially. So I said to them, tell me about how you rank this job compared to your previous work. And they said, oh, it's the best job I've ever had in my life. And I said, well, why do you feel that way? And almost to the person, they said, because I earn more money in this job than I've ever earned before. And it was such a shock to me. And suddenly I looked around the table, and these were the same young people who didn't know how to travel light, you know, through life. And they became very dependent on Bob Haldeman. And they engaged in these highly illicit activities. And I think one of the reasons was that they were very dependent on him for a job.
John Connolly.
My favorite American, yeah. I accepted this job as assistant to the president for international economics and chairman of a council similar to the National Security Council. And John Connolly had been vice chairman of the commission that set up this job. So about 1 month after I went there, the man who was Secretary of Treasury, a man named David Kennedy, was a close friend of mine from Chicago. And I was very relieved because obviously I had to relate to him. And suddenly, 30 days later, they fired him and put in John Connolly. And for a brief moment, I was relieved because he at least had been vice chairman of this commission. And then I discover that he didn't have the slightest intention of being coordinated by anybody. And he used to run around saying, if you think I came to this job to be coordinated by a bunch of White House staffers, forget it. I only communicate with the President of the United States. When I'm looking at Richard, you can imagine how difficult that makes a job where you're supposed to coordinate policy. And Nixon's attraction to Connolly was just astonishing to me because Connolly could lead him to make decisions that were 180 degrees contrary to what I thought were Republican principles. And I'll never forget the day on August 15th, 1971, when we closed the goal window, which was a very historic step in my field. And the president asked John Connolly if he could lay out the domestic program. And to my total astonishment, John Connolly lays out wage and price controls. Now, you can imagine, as a moderate liberal Republican, who I had listened to the president go on for some time about how he was in the Office of Price Administration in the war, and the one thing he was sure of was that this country could not tolerate a system of controls. And yet Connolly talked him into that, and he did that on several occasions. And because I do a lot of psychobabble, I guess, I was wondering what the psychological attraction was between these two men. And right or wrong, I concluded that Nixon at bottom, the president was, to use a current cliche, a low sense of self-esteem, and actually a misanthrope. He really didn't like people very much.
And had very few friends, as you say.
Very few friends. And, you know, to call a politician a misanthrope, you have to wonder whether you've got it right. But Connolly represented, in many ways, psychologically, what Richard Nixon wasn't. He was tall, good-looking, big, booming voice, gregarious, self-confident in the extreme, who would walk into a room and take it over. And I used to watch the president when John Connolly would walk into the room. And I'll probably get in trouble saying this, but I don't mean this was a physical attraction. But it was clear that he was kind of in love with John Connolly. And that's how some of these decisions got made, largely. And, you know, if Richard Nixon had had his way, John Connolly would have been president of the United States to take Spiro Agnew's place, and he wasn't able to sell that proposition. But the attraction was that deep. Chuck Colson?
Yep.
Another of my favorite Americans. I have a felicitous phrase for describing him. I called him the scab puller. And he used to walk into the president's office. And the president obviously had a slight touch of paranoia. So he would appeal to his paranoia by saying something like, you know that son of a bitch so-and-so. Let me tell you, Mr. President, what this guy is now saying about you, and he'd pull the scab off and the blood would start. And then the president would say, we have to get that son of a bitch, don't we? And that's where some of these things were hatched, you know, breaking into Dan Ellsberg's office, which, if you want to think about an invasion of privacy, what could be more invasive than invading somebody else's secret, you know, psychotherapeutic sessions? And he was capable of endless mischief. They had a policy in that White House, because most of them were advanced men in the Nixon campaign, of sound bites. And they kept telling you, if you're going to go out in the press room, you've got to have a 18-second sound bite. And what is it? So one day I get called by Colson, who said, Pete, I'm sending over a TV camera crew, and I've got a sound bite for you. George Meany, who was then the number one labor leader, ought to know about dictatorships. He runs the biggest dictatorship in the world. And I said, well, that'll certainly make the nightly news, but what reason would I have for saying such a thing? And he says, well, surely you know he called Richard Nixon a dictator. And I said, I know no such thing. And if he had, I would have think I'd heard about it. So I asked my deputy if he could look up some hearing that was held in Senate. You remember syllogisms and logic, proposition A, proposition B? Well, on page 8 of his briefing of this testimony, it went something like, there was a dictator once in Latin America who imposed price and wage controls. And, you know, about 20 pages later, now Richard Nixon is imposing, ergo, he has called him a dictator. So I called him back and I said, Chuck, he didn't call him a dictator, except in the most inferential way. And I said, by the way, do you know that I chair the Productivity Commission? And we're trying to get labor and business to cooperate on productivity. And do you know who my vice chairman is? He said, I haven't any idea. I said, well, it's George Meany. I said, I can't imagine a more felicitous thing to say to my vice chairman, or a way of dampening any chances of progress than this. Do you understand the President of the United States is ordering you? I said, no, I don't understand the President's ordering me. I understand you're ordering me. So I was always very grateful that I had a year in the White House where I could learn the personality traits of some of the characters.
Pete, there's one more experience I want to ask you about before we go to the foundation and questions from the floor. And that's in 1985, you and Steve Schwartzman, two guys with no investment track record, decide to start an investment firm. The outset didn't augur too well for all the money you were going to make, did it?
That was the longest, toughest period of my life, trying to raise money for a private equity firm when you don't have any track record. And all of the advisors to the big pension funds, that was the first question they raised. Indeed, the joke at my 65th birthday, you may recall, was Schwarzman plays a Japanese gentleman, and Peterson is calling on them to raise money. And Schwarzman says something, honorable sir, what a privilege, you probably remember this, to have such a senior figure from the United States calling us. What are you here for? And I said, well, sir, we're setting up a new private equity fund. He says, Mr. Peterson, it could not be true that you have no track record. I said, well, there are other things in life more important than a track record, you know. And so as the conversation goes, he said, well, what is unique about your private equity fund? And I said, we invest in Japan and Europe and the United States. And the punchline was, trilateral fund. Lose money all over the world. So So I have never been told no in more ways in my life than that first few years.
Very good. And then finally, Pete, the foundation. I think all of us are aware of the foundation because part of its mission is to advertise and make public concerns you have about the future. And this is your chance to say those things. And if you would include in it, Pete, because you and I talked a bit beforehand, you've got some thoughts about the current healthcare debate going on in Washington. If you can just wrap all that into one answer, I'd love to hear it, and then we'll go to the floor.
Well, I entitled the book The Education of an American Dreamer because I am a product of the American dream. And like the majority of the American people today, I fear that that dream is not going to be there for future generations on the current course. And I think the thing that makes it the least likely to continue is there are certain challenges out there that I would call long-term, that I would call structural, that I define as undeniable, unsustainable, and yet politically untouchable. You know, we had a Nixon humorist, I know that'll strike you as an oxymoron, in the White House, named Herbert Stein. He used to say, if something's unsustainable, it tends to stop. Or he said, if you don't like that one, if your horse dies, I suggest you dismount. And we keep riding this horse as though we can ride it indefinitely, even though it is unsustainable. And we picked three of the unsustainables to focus most of our initial efforts on. One is entitlements. Incidentally, I've never been more terrified to speak anywhere than here, because for me to be subjected to Ted Sorensen and Les Gelb in the same audience, when I think of the brutal assaults on me that have taken place about my previous books, the most infamous, of course, is once you put it down, you won't be able to pick it up, you know? Or his last one here was, Peterson's the ultimate self-made man, and oh, does he worship his creator. So, we're focusing on entitlements, which I've taken a lot of beatings on, Social Security, Medicare. We're trying to tell the American people the undeniable truth. We tell them that their public debt is doubled in the last 8 years to $11 trillion, and isn't that terrible? What we don't tell the American people is there's another $45 trillion of unfunded promises out there for Social Security and Medicare that would result in unfinanceable financing and unthinkable taxes, a doubling of taxes that directly threaten the future. So we're working on educating, motivating the people on that. The second problem that I think has very clear foreign policy implications, and we've asked the Peterson Institute in Washington, rather poorly named it seems to me, but about foreign debt projections if we continue on our current path. And I think, Richard, it's a problem worthy of quite a lot of foreign policy thinking, because they concluded that even among some of the more benign scenarios, in not too many years, the foreign debt of the United States reaches levels that leave us remarkably vulnerable to foreign lending. And it is something that not only has grave economic risk if they were to decide not to continue to lend or to lend at much higher interest rates with an effect on inflation, but also it could have very serious geopolitical implications. All of us in this room remember the Eisenhower years and the, what was it, Richard, 54 or something? The Suez Canal situation in which the Brits sent in troops to take over the Suez Canal, which is directly contrary to American policy. And we held huge amounts, as the Chinese do now, of British pound securities. We got a hold of the foreign policy officials and said to them, this is against American policy, and if you persist in this, we're going to have to dump these securities. And what was it, Richard? Within 10 days or a few weeks, whatever it was, they withdrew their troops. Well, there's nothing to say that the Chinese or others could not do exactly the same thing. And the third one is the health care costs that you asked me to say something about. We spend about $7,000 per capita in the United States for health care, compared to the rest of the world, about $3,500, with no difference in health outcomes that anybody has been able to get. And the costs are rising to the point that they threaten to our very competitiveness as a country. And I guess in the spirit of candor within these hallowed halls, I'm very concerned about the way the discussion in Washington is going. Because on the one hand, the administration, and Peter Orszag is speaking here tomorrow, and he is remarkably well informed on health care costs. We made a brilliant case that the fundamental problem with our system is the health care costs. But if you look at what has been proposed, there is remarkably little that has anything to do with health care costs and has a lot to do with increasing health care costs. And the problem, I'm sure, is that they feel they're confronted with political constraints of something I write about in the book, where we've become a all gain and no pain society. I want it all, and I don't want to pay for it. Sacrifice is a terminal word politically, and all that sort of thing. So we try to solve this problem just through tax increases. Well, we're never going to solve this problem by tax increases, in my opinion. And just to give you an idea of the things that are wrong with the system that we're not doing anything about that have a lot to do with why we spend so much. As some of you probably know, we have a payment system where we pay the medical institution according to procedures, not according to results. So you pay per visit, pay per test, and so forth. We shouldn't be surprised, for example, that we have six times the MRI tests per capita that Germany has, who has at least as good a health outcome. We have a situation, but we're doing nothing about the payment system, which is a perverse. If I were to design a system to maximize costs, I couldn't do much better than the one that they have come up with. We don't have a budget. We're the only developed country in the world without a budget. And therefore, we don't have to make tough decisions. And we treat the word rationing as though it's some strange, ten-letter word. Well, almost everything in life is rationed in some way or other. We have inexplicable variations across the country that would not be tolerated in any company I can think of. For example, there are counties and regions of the country where there are six times the back operations as in others, and six times the prostate removals. Well, I know there are red states and blue states, but am I to believe that we have bad prostate states and, you know, bad back states? We spend 25 to 35% of Medicare in the last year of life. Other countries have asked and answered the very difficult questions of what is it that it is appropriate for the government to pay for, and yet we can't even discuss the subject. So if you go to New York Hospital Intensive Care Unit, you will be very depressed to see the number of people who are in the last months of life with a terrible quality of life, virtually in a coma situation, where the costs are of heroic intervention are extreme. The one place where you can get lower costs and better health outcomes are in clinics, the Mayo Clinic, and there are about six of them in the country. And I would have thought part of the right program is to figure out some way of developing a lot of clinics in a hurry, because they get better results at about 25-30% less money. But there's nothing in the program, about that. And then we give tax exclusions so that fat cats like those of us at Blackstone, looking at health care as compensation and saying, what else do we do at Blackstone where we can get compensation, not pay any taxes on it, regardless of how excessive the program is? So I would have been much happier if they had somehow linked specific things to do with costs to the expansion of the coverage. But as usually happens in this country, we want to eat the dessert before we have the spinach. And I'm sure they would say it's tough to do. But hey, folks, that is one of my messages. We have to confront some tough choices, or we have to give up something. And we have not done that on the health care program, in my opinion.
Very good. I want to go to the floor for questions.
Will you assure me you're not going to ask Sorensen or
If I see Sorensen, he is the first one I will call upon, but I haven't seen him yet. I know he's on the list to be here. Couldn't make it. Okay, too bad.
Good.
But here's an abusive question from the second row. And would you please identify yourself?
I'm Gerald Pollack. Mr. Peterson, you cited Herb Stein, having said that things that are unsustainable will come to a stop. How do you see this unsustainable trend in our budget situation coming to an end? What scenarios seem plausible
to you?
Well,
we have Bob Rubin here, who knows much, much more than I do about this. But this Peterson Institute study said that before you reach these horrible numbers on foreign debt, it was very likely that action would be taken by the foreign lenders, who would look at our situation and conclude that this situation is not sustainable. So if I had to guess on the most likely next crisis, and I hope to hell we don't have to depend on a crisis to wake it up, because it'd be a very costly crisis, it'll be in the foreign exchange markets, where the foreign lenders decide that we're not getting our house in order, inflation is very likely, a drop in the dollar is likely, so either don't lend or lend at a much higher price. If that happens, it stirs inflation. It makes our housing problem far worse, obviously, and it results in very slow growth. So I think the foreign exchange markets is the place I would worry about. I don't know what Bob Rubin thinks.
Pete, there's a real live journalist in the hall, and she just raised her hand. So would you identify yourself, please, Evelyn?
Yeah.
And wait for the...
Sorry, Evelyn Leopold, a UN-based journalist. Do you see signs now of China using its muscle because of how much we owe them in the political field? I see some in the Security Council, but it looks like it's just beginning.
Well, I think the noises they've made about the need for a different exchange rate system is a way of implicitly saying the power balance has shifted, and we're sitting here talking to you about changing the exchange rate system. I was called on the other day by a senior Chinese official who I've known for some time. And I don't know how, I'm not a China expert, I don't know to what extent he typifies the attitude of the most senior officials, but he's fairly senior. He said, Peter, you have been talking about the budget deficits for some time, but my God, the numbers now of nearly $2 trillion is beyond anything that we could have imagined. And besides, he said, you know, we have a stimulus program of our own for which we need resources to stimulate domestic, you know, demand. And beside, our exports are down 25%. Have you contemplated where you're going to get all these trillions of dollars? And he said, it's a subject that worries us quite a bit, what the implications would be. So I have zero evidence, maybe Richard does, that there's any, that they're using it in foreign policy discussions. I don't know, Richard, if you're aware of that. But they're certainly beginning to nibble at the edges of using it as economic leverage, or what you might call their financial guillotine.
Bob Rubin in the back.
Pete, you said that what our country likes, is unwilling to do is to face pain and difficult issues in our political system. What do you think can be done to change the political equation? And if you were advising somebody who's running for office, how would you suggest they deal with the politics of making tough decisions? But mostly, how do you think we can change the political equation in the minds of our political leaders?
It seems to me that on the short term, the only process I can see that has any possibility of attacking some of these really fundamental undeniables like entitlements is through a special kind of bipartisan commission. These problems will never be handled on a partisan basis, because I was brought up in Nebraska, used to hunt occasionally, and we had something called the turkey shoot phenomenon, where the poor turkey that lifted its head first got it shot off. The way the politicians look at this matter is, if I lift my head up and suggest a reform that involves some pain, I'm likely to get it shut off. So it requires presidential leadership, thorough bipartisanship, and it requires, I think, both parties to put some sacred principles on the table. The Republican Party at the present time has so many people who've never met a tax cut they didn't like or a tax increase they didn't hate, and therefore all solutions end up with some kind of tax cut proposal as though that's the solution to our problems. Our Democratic friends, on the other hand, have rarely met an entitlement expansion they didn't like. So we end up with this awful worst of both worlds, big tax cuts and big spending. There is no solution to this problem that doesn't involve, most significantly, cuts in benefits and so forth, but also some tax increases. And I think the only way that's going to take place is in some kind of commission, I mean, absent a crisis, where you approach it the way we approach military bases. Do you all remember how we do that? You know, closing a single military base is impossible because whose ever district it falls in raises so much hell that it becomes impossible. So what they tend to do is look at the nation's needs and a group of bases that need to be closed, and you have to vote up or down on those. I think some process of that sort has to take place. Now, on Bob's broader question, the public, first of all, has to get educated. At the present time, it's very easy to blame the politicians. And if you've read any American history, of which I've read all too little, when the founders set up this country, they never envisioned this kind of a Congress in which people come in here and treat these jobs as careers. You came in for a short session, and you went back home after you achieved a purpose. So we shouldn't be surprised that the politicians think more about the next election than they do the next generation. And what we've got to do is somehow get the public to get themselves expressed. I've had many private meetings with the top leaders, and at one level it's comforting, and the other it's very depressing. I have yet to meet with a senior leader that when you lay out the problems, they say, yes, they are undeniable, they are unsustainable, but we need political help. Now, we're going to spend a lot of the money that we're put in here on various kinds of communication, including, of course, the young. You remember the old joke, philosophy class, in which the professor says, which is worse, ignorance or apathy? And some kid from the back says, I don't know and I don't care. Well, I have a fantasy. And the fantasy is that we somehow have something that I would call the American Association of Young People, not of retired people, but of young people, themselves and their parents, marching onto Washington and screaming in the context of the movie Network, I'm madder than hell and I'm not going to take it anymore. And I think we have to somehow get the public energized, because at bottom, this is truly a moral issue that I'm talking about. It's not just an economic issue. And it was Bonhoeffer who once said, the ultimate test of a moral society is the kind of world it leaves to its children. And what we're leaving to our kids is immoral. And we've somehow got to get the kids and their parents politically organized to march on Washington. And I'm constantly asked, Bob, are you out of your mind putting so much of your money into this? And I remind them of something I learned at the University of Chicago, where a wonderful Nobel Prize winner, George Stigler, with a great sense of humor, once said, if you have no alternative, you have no problem. And it's amazing how that principle has guided some of my decisions. And somehow the alternative of being on my deathbed in a few years and being this concerned about the problem and not doing anything about it, or trying, is not an alternative. And I'm not saying it isn't very difficult, Bob, but I think ultimately, if we don't get the public involved, it's going to be very difficult to change this equation.
By the way, you ended up at the University of Chicago Graduate School through sort of a dumb luck adventure, and also it gives me a chance to remind the audience that you were expelled from MIT before that all happened.
Thank you so much for pointing out. You know, nothing requires you to engage in total disclosure. No, it's a... I give a series of examples of dumb luck in life. I was working at 39 South LaSalle in Chicago, and I was going to get my graduate degree at night, night school. And I'm walking to the train station, and at 19 South LaSalle, I see the University of Chicago Graduate School. And I'm embarrassed to say the only reason I went there was that it was closer than Northwestern. Fast forward, I taught there for about 5 years part-time, and many of my best friends were there. And one of them was George Shultz. And George Shultz calls me one day and says, Pete, the president wants to see you tomorrow. And my whole life changed as a result of that. And it's kind of dumb luck.
Pete, let me just ask you one last question, unless there are any more out there. That is, you became chairman here in 1985, and you did that, I think, 22 years, is correct. What did you find here when you got here, and what did you want to see the council become?
Well, I was in the market research business at one point, and I thought it would, since this was a membership organization, it would be very useful to do a survey of the members. And we hired a top pollster, and we confidentially surveyed the members. And I found a rather pervasive, implicit sense of unhappiness that somehow the council wasn't a more prominent public voice in the field of foreign policy. And, you know, its origins were terribly secret and so forth, and every meeting was not for attribution and so forth. And I found that the members wanted us to be part of the national scene. And so we started to engage in outreach programs of various kinds. We had task forces that were bipartisan and were headed on a bipartisan basis by leaders. We had press conferences. Richard, you'll recall that we even had four attribution meetings, which was quite a revelation. We discovered something very interesting. We had thought that people wanted secret meetings. The speakers did. But when we interviewed the speakers, they said, in effect, there is no such thing as a secret meeting, and I want exposure. So curiously, perversely enough, the way we got the best speakers was to offer them a four attribution session. But we made a lot of changes, and Les Galb, I think, by most accounts, was a great partner in spite of his personal assaults. And it was a great time, but it was certainly time to step down. And I think in Bob Rubin and Carly Hills and Richard in particular, we have a better team than ever here. And when you leave an institution, you want it to be stronger after you leave than when it was there. And I think that's the way the foundation is today.
Great. Pete, on behalf of the Old Farts and Airhead Society, thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.